Hello and welcome to the latest Insider interview. Our guest today is Paul Niven, manager of the Super 60 rated F&C Investment Trust. Paul, thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
The trust invests globally. Can you give me a whistle-stop tour of what you own?
So the trust does invest globally. We've got exposure to listed equities, around about 90% of the portfolio, and also private equity, which is the remainder. We invest into a range of underlying strategies, which in turn invest into specific areas of the market. So we've got 8 to 10 individual strategies that invest into listed equities, so European exposure, US large cap growth, US large cap value. We've got a global income strategy, and each of those individual strategies runs a concentrated exposure, maybe around 40 stocks in terms of the most attractive stocks that we see within that particular segment of the market. The reason we do that is essentially to provide diversification across a range of different geographies, sectors, and also investment styles. So we're a broadly diversified portfolio investing in listed equity and private equity.
And what are your biggest underweights and overweights at the moment when compared with your benchmark?
If you look at the portfolio in aggregate, geographically, we're not too different actually from the overall benchmark. We've got a long position on UK equities. We've got a modest long position within the listed component on US equities. We're underweight in European equities and emerging markets, but those positions are not particularly big. If you look at the individual stocks which we invest in, some of our key overweights in terms of the top 10 and bottom 10, for example, relate to, for example, Hess Energy, Phillips 66, both energy companies, clearly. We also have overweight positions in United Health and International Flavors and Fragrances, which is a provider of inputs to food manufacturers. Conversely, on the underweight side of things, some of our biggest underweights are, for example, in Apple and Microsoft, some of those big tech names which had performed extremely well.
Let's talk about energy. So what makes that such an attractive sector for you? Is it the higher than average oil price? Is it a supply demand dynamic? What's going on there?
So one of the reasons that we have this overweight to some of those specific names in terms of our some of our key stock positions is really been the increased allocation that we've made to large cap value stocks, and energy is clearly a more significant component of that type of portfolio than it is the market overall, and also the exposure that we've increased in terms of the income exposure on the portfolio. So the changes that we've made out of large cap growth stocks into value and income have essentially led to that overweight position on some of those energy names, as well as the underlying managers who manage those components selecting those stocks. The reason for the preference for those names really relates to an underpricing in terms of expectations against current stock price of what the manager believes the future oil price trajectory is likely to be, and continued supply shortages combined with clearly what has been quite a marked upturn in demand.
And why are you underweight America's technology giants? These have been amazing companies to invest in over the past decade, and anybody who's avoided them has been punished by markets. So why do you think that you are right?
So we did have a very significant position in terms of US technology stocks. We still have exposure, as I said. We made a conscious decision in the second half of 2020 to start materially reducing our exposure to large cap US growth stocks. In fact, if you compare our exposure from that point in 2020 to where we are now, we've got roughly half of the exposure that we did in terms of US large cap growth. Our view was that the fundamental backdrop was likely to change in the sense that we were going to see a rise in inflation, rise in interest rates, both of which are less conducive to longer duration growth stocks. In addition, we'd observed that the valuation premium on that area of the market had got to very large levels. So the change in fundamental backdrop, which we foresaw, which has actually unfolded, along with those extended valuations, led to us pivoting away from US large cap growth. Doesn't mean those companies are not great businesses, they're fantastic businesses, but ultimately one has to be mindful about what price you pay for that exposure. And unfortunately, I think as things stand today, that premium probably still a little bit rich in my mind.
Are there any types of companies or countries that you avoid completely? Take China, for example. Do you allocate money there?
We do have exposure to China. We are slightly underweight in terms of our Chinese equity exposure. We did restrict exposure to Russia and Belarus following the invasion and divested as best we could from the very limited exposure which we had to those names. But beyond that, we have a broad universe from which we can select.
And you said at the moment there's no allocation to global smaller companies. Why is that?
Given the backdrop which we envisaged, which again was rising inflation, rising interest rates, we felt that it was going to be more conducive in terms of pricing power for large over small. Rising labour costs, large companies tend to have more by way of pricing power in terms of inputs, and that includes labour. There'll be numerous exceptions to this general rule, but in general, we felt it was an environment that would be more conducive for large over small. That said, valuation of smaller companies has improved markedly, but we wanted to be focused, concentrated, and given it was a relatively small part of the portfolio, we felt we should divest in entirety, which is what we did.
The trust has been a great performer, particularly versus the peer group. Against benchmark, it's winning over 10 years, but the difference is less substantial. So why should investors own F&C rather than a simple tracker fund where there's no chance that the manager might make a wrong investment decision?
So as you said, we've delivered very strong returns in absolute terms over longer periods and relative terms over all periods. We've delivered top quartile returns against the investment trust competitors year to date, 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, 10 years. And over 10 years, we've delivered a return to shareholders of about 245% against our benchmark, which is about 215%. So quite material outperformance over the longer time periods, as well as good returns over shorter time periods as well. The question about active management against passive management really is one of customer choice. We have, as I said, delivered good excess returns, so I think there's a good proof statement there. The closed-ended fund structure which we operate gives us advantages in terms of being able to take a long-term perspective, use gearing, and also invest in illiquid areas like private equity, and that can be accretive to returns, and certainly that has been our experience. But fundamentally, if you buy a passive fund, you're buying the winners of yesterday, given that essentially you're buying the largest companies by virtue of their historic performance. So our ability to take active positions, whether it's geographically, sectorally, at the individual stock level, we believe can lead to excess returns, as we have demonstrated, against indices over longer time periods.
Private equity is one of those advantages. It's about 10% of the portfolio. Can you talk me through how you invest in private equity and what types of companies you actually own?
So private equity, as you said, is around 10% of the overall investment portfolio, just a little over today. Been a long-term investor into private equity. We have experienced a good level of excess return from our private market exposure over long periods of time, albeit last year we had a return of around about 30% from our private equity portfolio. That compared to listed markets of around 20%. Year to date, to the end of June, we delivered a return of 4.5%, thereabouts, percent return from private equity in a period when listed markets were down. But as I said, over long time periods, we've delivered good levels of excess return from that private over public exposure. So we think as a closed-ended fund, we should take advantage of the ability to invest in illiquid areas in terms of private exposure. We invest into both unlisted fund investments and co-investment exposure, which is essentially stakes in individual companies. And the way that we do that and source those investments is by using our internal team within Columbia Threadneedle, who essentially source deals which are then brought to me as manager of the trust, which can then be put into the portfolio. And we also work with Pantheon, who are a leading investor in the private market space, who source and select hard to access leading growth and venture managers on a global basis for us. And just one example, last year we realized an investment in pet supply stores in southeastern Europe. We invested in 2018. We made a return of just under 30 million euros, and that is a 4.2 times return on investment into that individual position. But we invest predominantly using the Columbia Threadneedle team into mid-market buyout opportunities.
Finally, the question we ask all of our interviewees, do you personally invest in the trust?
I do have exposure to F&C Investment Trust as part of my investment portfolio. I was a shareholder in the trust before I became manager back in 2014, and I've continued to invest on behalf of myself and my family.
Paul, thanks very much for coming into the studio.
Thank you.
And that's all we have time for. You can check out more insider interviews on our YouTube channel, where you can like, comment, and subscribe. See you next time.